Have you got your espresso? Hello, welcome to episode 106 of the Online Tennis Podcast. Honoured to be joined by John Silk to talk the men's US Open, Novak Djokovic winning number 24 over Daniil Medvedev in his 10th US Open final. How are we doing, John?
I'm doing okay. We spoke off air, but we actually spoke about this on air last night as well, that in the end, the final turned out to be a bit of an anti-climax. So that's where we're at. Sorry, listeners and viewers, such a downbeat beginning. We'll lift things up. We'll try anyway.
Yeah, there's definitely peaks and troughs to the tournament that we can talk about a little bit. But and the significance of what it all means going forward could be a little deflating, but it's interesting to put into context and stuff. And I think the best place to start, John, is the actual match. We'll try and salvage what we can from it, as you suggested there. And as you heard from me so much before the match, I mean, how excited was I? I was like, it's going to be Medvedev in five sets. The matchup has been so different every single time they've played. And then, do you know, there was a moment in the second set where had it went the way of Medvedev, we might have had an exciting match. But when that second set was done and dusted, same for you, me, Damien, we all knew at that point it was probably done. Bigger picture first, right? So for the whole match, it looked as though Medvedev came into this trying to fatigue Djokovic. He knew that the heavy conditions would kind of stop him breathing properly. It would make him lose his legs. Exactly what Novak said, actually, said in the second set. He was losing air, losing his legs. Medvedev had a set point. You know, he did have a chance to take that second set. So the game plan wasn't bad, per se. He was outlasting Novak from the back of the court quite frequently. And actually, had he not been broken in that literally steal of a second game in the first set, he would have went a long time without getting his serve broken. So it's not like he was doing too much wrong on serve. You know, he was really nailing that one down the tee. He was serving well in general. I don't know how much I can really knock Medvedev with a little bit of hindsight, because again, I felt really disappointed in Medvedev. And I will get into how there was one tactic that really bothered me, obviously. I'm sure you could guess what it is. But generally, you know, the way Medvedev framed it, I would kind of agree with. He said regrets for sure, should have won it. But probably if he'd went into the match, he would have done the same thing. You know, it's quite hard in the heat of the moment to change all these tactics up, especially if you have a feeling it's going to work. He said he had a feeling of everything he was doing was going to work. A little bit stubborn, he said, on return and stuff. I don't fault him too much. He did keep his head fairly well, bar the third set. Yeah, let's just get into why I'm annoyed at Medvedev though as well. The one tactic that really bothered me, and the one that kept saving Novak over and over again, was the serve and volley. Particularly the serve out wide for Novak in the juice court. Medvedev was not returning well enough from that point of view. Right, so often he would get burned, not find the return, or find the return and fair play. Novak hit a pretty good volley, but he literally lost every single serve and volley point Novak played up until the final game. And Medvedev did touch on the fact he could have moved forward a little bit earlier, and he was a bit too stubborn maybe staying that far back. And when he did eventually move forward, and not like to the point where he's Andy Murray, but he did move forward a little bit from his house, as Alcaraz framed it, and it did work for him. He hit a passing shot in the final game. So maybe there's a little bit of regrets there. But overall, I don't know if there was much more Medvedev could have done. I think the tactics were right. And in the end, it was kind of just a little bit of Novakism that stole the pressure points, maybe, John.
I think your expression about what you quoted Daniela saying, you know, he'd probably do the same thing. I do get that. I just think he needs to do it better. It's not easy, I know, especially under pressure, Grand Slam final, you know, 23 and now 24 Grand Slam title winner on the other side of the net, but he probably needed to return a little bit better. I wouldn't go quite as far as to say the second set was a steal or was more Medi, because don't forget the first seven games, I think it was, he didn't even win a point on Novak's serve. So if you put it into two halves, if you just focus, and of course we always recency bias, we always look at the end of the set and go, oh, you know, he had a set point, he was close to breaking, Novak was struggling. But even in that period, that sort of six, seven game period, the second half of the second set, he wasn't able to continue that through the tiebreak and then in particular into the third set. As in, I don't remember any sort of 30, 40 shot rallies where both players are being moved from side to side. When the point ends, one or both players are like struggling for breath. That didn't really occur in the third set. The rallies felt a bit shorter, and that may well be because Novak did a great job in doing so. But I also think Daniil began to tire a little bit and maybe was playing with even more margin. I think his margin between sort of midpoint of second set to the end of the second set was just on the button. It was enough margin, keeping it inside most of the time, just inside the baseline, just inside the tram lines or whatever. But then it started as the set or the match wore on, it did sort of go back down towards the middle, which again, possibly was due to a bit of fatigue. I don't know if he's mentioned that afterwards or if he was even asked it, but I do think that even Daniil was just in the third set was just, I'm not saying that if it had gone to a fourth, he could rejuvenate as we see with Novak. And yeah, that's what I would say. And returning as well. So do the same thing, but maybe a little bit better. I think we might slightly disagree, Jack, in that the return position, I just don't know. Maybe he made a slight adjustment there and he was a bit further in. I think the anticipation against Carlos worked well, but then Carlos didn't serve as well as Novak did yesterday. So
yeah,
all of those things.
A little on that, I touched on it during the stream last night. John, Alcaraz just not able to hit that T serve as well as Novak. And you saw Medvedev almost cheating over to cover that sliding serve, where he couldn't really do the same thing against Novak. But seeing that, he didn't even take any gambles. He didn't try and move out there a little early. When you get to the point where you're 18 out of 18 lost in that department, you've got to start doing something a bit different. And he genuinely hadn't won a single point against the serve and volley until about that final game of the match.
That is probably something that he could have done, is just go over there. I mean, if it ends up going the opposite direction or you misread the serve, hopefully you can also get a read on that serve. I mean, it's one of the best, if not one of the best of all time and one of the best on tour, whatever your thoughts are, especially spot-wise. But if you can sort of just, even if you lose a couple of points just because you're spending too much time watching him, you know, he lost 18 in a row, so losing two of them wouldn't have mattered. On top of that, even if you're also just guessing, well, that guess, you know, if it doesn't work out a couple of times, you're still up, if you like. You can't be any worse than 18 out of 18.
Yeah, and exactly.
I probably will say one more thing on the Novak volleying. I think it's completely fair and completely right to highlight just how good a volleyer he is. You need to be a good volleyer to do this. However, I remember one really good one that Owen and I really rate highly, although I think, I'm not sure if it was you or Damien on the stream, were less enthusiastic about. But Owen and I were really enthusiastic about that half, I think it was a half volley pickup at some point, maybe in the second.
I honestly just said that from personal experience. I love those shots. I think they're quite easy feel shots compared to like low volleys.
So he was on the stretch quite a bit.
But, he was.
Yeah. Anyway.
I'm not saying I could pull that off, John. but I am just saying I think it's easier than a really low volley is all I would say. It's a bit easier than Alex, but not much. It's still hard. Right, saying that, so a few chances missed for Medvedev. This is what I want to talk about just before we close up because I don't want to get too depressed about this match. But chances missed, the set point, Medvedev touched on it. He had a passing shot and passing shots of Medvedev are going down as my least valuable shot for this match. He had the chance to go down the line. He goes cross. He said that exactly as he said in the press conference. Could have went line, went cross, and regretted it instantly. He was trying to outfox Novak a lot when he was at the net and just not going for the percentage plays a lot of the time. Novak was kind of in his head in that department, and it was a bit of a shame. And the other thing I'd say that Goran Ivanišević, said that when Novak starts to get nervy, I didn't realise that his toss starts to go a lot into the court, right? And we saw double faults start to appear, right? You know, he was collapsing into them a little bit, into the net. There was chances when Novak was fatiguing, getting a little nervier, for Medvedev to step in, and it didn't really happen, Joe.
Yeah. One more thing. With Medvedev, I can't make my mind up in terms of passing, because to some extent, I would also add, of course, the return in the pass, because if the guy's coming into the net, it's difficult, I know, when you're that far out wide, but I'm adding that in so that when I look at passing shots, I would add that as part of it. But even just in normal play, if you like, I'm not sure where I stand. Some days I do think, oh, he's not a great passer, if you like, and other days he's great. And so I can't really make my mind up on Daniil. And yesterday was not a good day. Chances, you say, set point. There were other points just in the from 4-3, I think it was, because I think Medvedev was serving first from memory in that second set, wasn't he? 4-3, I think it was, and he hadn't had a point on Novak's serve all set, and then suddenly the next two or three service games from Novak, he was in them. You know, once he finally got off the mark, I think at 15-all, he was suddenly in that service game, and he was certainly in a couple more, including break points and then also ultimately a set point. And there were some times he went into the body of Novak and it was like, what? Or sometimes he did a net rush at just at the complete random moment. And I mentioned this earlier on this year when Jan Anders Struff played Carlos in Madrid. And it's like, I get it, in Madrid against Carlos and the circumstances and Jan Lennard's, you know, I hope you don't mind me saying this, Jan Lennard, but his level and expectation, if you like, he has to mix things up a bit. And he did great in that Madrid final and was very close to potentially winning it. Daniel doesn't have to do that much. It's not like there's a chasm on a hard court, especially in New York, between these two players. So again, he doesn't have to be random. He doesn't have to do a strange net rush at an unusual time. He doesn't have to do an unusual shot mid-rally or go for the body when Novak wouldn't expect it. Daniel's conventional, which for us can sometimes be unconventional, is great. Unfortunately, we just didn't see it often enough yesterday.
Yeah, it's a really good way of putting it. I do think a tiny bit of discipline missing in that second set, just a tiny bit, and that's sometimes enough to make the biggest difference, because you're right, there was a few moments of just like, what are you doing, Dan? What are you doing? Like, I am going to touch on the Medvedev-Alcaraz match, albeit it feels a little bit, it doesn't really fit the narrative now, obviously, but it would be nice just to talk about it anyway, sure. And then talk about Novak's, the kind of significance of everything that's happened, basically, and what it means for the tennis landscape. Medvedev Alcaraz first. Obviously, one of the most fascinating turnarounds of a matchup we've ever seen, I would argue. Two, you know, matches in a row at Indian Wells and Wimbledon, where Medvedev gets absolutely trounced, and then he turns the head-to-head around and manages to defeat him here in the semis of the US Open, when basically nobody was giving him a chance. It's not just down to him lighting up, though. There was a few things that I really want to point out in terms of tactics and how the surfaces make a big difference. Right, so first, difference when returning here compared to Wimbledon. That's one of the biggest things. Medvedev was in so many of his return games, mm-hmm. where Wimbledon, he just wasn't doing much damage when he did get the ball back into play. And everybody was like, oh, you need to move forwards. He stuck to his guns, stayed back, and it worked here. And I would argue it's because at Wimbledon, when you return, even though the court speeds are quite similar, one thing he did mention is the sliding serve is so much more biting in the grass, so much more scathing, totally gets you off the court. And it's a little bit easier then for Alcaraz to get forward. Even then, though, even if Medvedev did get the return back, it's quite hard for him to keep the ball out of Alcaraz's attacking zone, if that makes sense. So if he returns at the US Open, the ball's a little bit higher. It's a little bit more suited to his forehand, which is a little flatter. And we saw that throughout the entirety of the match. Right, so not only is the sliding serve not as effective, but he's able to attack more with his forehand, which two massive things that already make a big difference, right? Especially if you're going to do any damage with your forehand as Medvedev against Alcaraz, you have to have something to tee off of. So although people are saying low bounces actually help Medvedev, only if you want to keep going neutral and stay defensive. He had to sometimes find a way past Alcaraz. You have to find a way past Alcaraz. You can't just let him play every point aggressively, right? So actually, the high bounce helped him a lot here. The higher bounce than Wimbledon helped a lot. And last thing, John, just before I get your thoughts, and shout out to Joseph Watford on Twitter, by the way, and I'm very keen to get him on the show at some point. He had some fascinating stuff to say on Twitter. He does seem keen, so we might get him on. How often did Daniel get stuck in a backhand cross-court rally? Very infrequently. If you've watched any of Medvedev's matches, that is his bread and butter. He absolutely changed up his tactical playbook to defeat Alcaraz and changed direction often going into the Alcaraz forehand. Because if you want to avoid the Alcaraz forehand, you actually can't camp in the ad court, because Alcaraz is always looking for that inside out one, right? The really high, spinny, heavy one to the backhand. Get it to the forehand frequently, but not too frequently, just enough. Then actually, it hurts Alcaraz a lot more, especially if you go in there with pace. And Medvedev got the balance so perfect, so amazingly. Maybe that's why I had Medvedev so high ranked for that final. I really thought, you know, this, he couldn't have played any better than that match. So it was a little bit deflating when he did eventually come down from that high? How did you feel?
Probably
about it,
needed to do another 11, 12 out of 10 in the final, possibly.
Yes.
But I love that Twitter account as well, by the way. He has some great stuff and on that semi-final in particular. On Alcaraz, though, there's always two sides to every story. He was he had one or two break opportunities right at the beginning of the match, I think, and he didn't take them. But it was like no big deal because they're going to come thick and fast. Well, actually, they didn't. He played a bad tie break from 3-all. I think he highlighted that and ended up losing that one 7-3. And as a result, carried that over into the second set. I think he said that in his press conference too, that sort of hangover was still there. And I remember one backhand when he sort of bailed on in a rally. His footwork was not great, which is, of course, just odd for someone as good as Alcaraz. And when I say bailed on the rally, of course, he wanted to win it, but I think he became a bit overambitious. It was awkward. It didn't look right, and he netted, and it kind of summed up his second set for me. And I think we'll never know quite whether the hamstring issue was becoming an issue with the movement or not. So, two sides to every coin, but Daniil fully deserved that win. Did great to turn around that head-to-head. I still imagine that that Carlos will end up probably having a comfortable, nice, favourable head-to-head over Medvedev.
One other thing to touch on. As you say, Alcaraz, you know, there was a side to his story as well, and maybe could be accused of overplaying the serve and volley at one point in the fourth set, right, where maybe tactically just went a little bit off the boil, didn't want to hang in the baseline rallies with Medvedev, serve and volley basically every point at 3-2, and was eventually broken. There was a lot of game points there that Medvedev had to save. He just kept telling himself he could win this game, he could win this game. There was a lot of amazing gets from Medvedev. So few and far between against Novak. It's unreal. And there were so many moments of just Medvedev magic in that one game, and we barely saw it in the final. So again, that was your 11 out of 10 moments. There was loads of amazing passes in that game. Problem was, Carlos then became wasn't surprising to Medvedev at all that he was coming in. You know, he could set up for it. He was cheating over to that sliding serve in the deuce court, but he wasn't doing that against Novak. A little bit of maturity, as Alcaraz suggested. You know, he didn't know how to deal with that sort of adversity in those moments. Very mature of him, ironically, to admit. Mm-hmm. 100% Medvedev deserved it. One of the matches of the year for me, John. Let's talk a little bit about Novak's benchmark that he has now set. The benchmark for everybody to overcome. Can anybody do it? Here's a few stats that I'm sure you'll be very interested in hearing, and then I'll get your immediate thoughts, John. Sure. It feels as though the men's tennis field at the moment is lacking in depth. We've got three big players, and apart from that, there's not really much competition for Novak to contest with. As he said, one of the biggest lessons he's learned, he said this at his press conference, is mentally, even if you find a formula that works, it's not a guarantee that it'll work. And probably most likely it's not going to work the next year. So he's constantly reinventing himself, even while he's at the top of the game, and absolutely nobody can keep up. Maybe Alcaraz, maybe Medvedev, the rest, absolutely not. This is the stat I want to give you, John. 2019 to 2023, semi-finals and finals at Grand Slams. We have had 18 different opponents for Djokovic to face. Medvedev, Tsitsipas, Zverev and team make up 9 of those semi-finals and finals. In the 2011 to 2015 period, 11 different opponents, and Federer and Murray Nadal make up 22 of those semi-finals and finals. 22 compared to 9. I mean, how much does that tell you?
Yeah, well, it's in black and white, but it's somewhere in our brains. I think that was there. That players such as even Dominic Thiem, of course, who does have a semi-final Grand Slam win over Medvedev in 2019, I think it was. It does tell us that well, it also add on top of that, it's just that you did have a 4. And I think it's Mary Carrillo that used to talk about the 3, but you could argue the 4, as in 10 years ago, used to hunt in packs, and they would hunt everyone else down, and then they would be there or thereabouts in the last 4. So Novak's record when he's coming up against Andy or against Rafa or against Roger, of course, isn't going to be as good as it is against Steph or against Dominic or against Daniil or against Sasha, because those four players are light years away in every sense from the other players we just mentioned. As in, I don't just mean in how many Grand Slams they've won, because, you know, Daniil's only two away, I guess, from Andy. But Daniil is given a pass, I think, on this one, as we sort of touched on. But many of the other ones are not close to winning a Grand Slam right now and may never win a Grand Slam, never mind multiple or double-digit Grand Slams. And I wonder if maybe they are a little bit stubborn, or I don't see an evolution in Steph's game, really. I think Sasha, for example, has obviously had that horrible injury that he had last year. But that was his peak, probably. And I still think he's a little short of that. He may well return to that. But don't forget, that was his peak and it still wasn't quite enough. You know, we knew that. And by the way, I would just want to say one other thing. You said there's a sort of toe-to-toe with Novak. It's kind of 2.5 with Daniil, because it is only for two Grand Slams out of four, if you like. Two periods of the year. I know he has Rome, but that's an exception. And he didn't beat, of course, Novak en route to that title. So it's kind of 2.5 with Daniil anyway. And so then you're looking at the rest of the tour, you know, they're not, when I say not good enough, it sounds particularly harsh, but actually that's the nice thing. That's the nice way of saying it, that maybe Casper Ruud is not as good as those players, and that's okay. But somebody like Stefanos Tsitsipas, for example, and probably Sasha Zverev too, won't necessarily like to hear that. But that may be part of the problem, that there's not a like, okay, well, what can I do? Rather than just being like, I think I could be that good. I think I can be. But Steph's backhand seems to have regressed rather than progressed since 2021. I'm not saying it was the best backhand in the world in 2021, but it was very manageable for 6 months. Sasha obviously had the injury, so I guess there's that reasoning. But as I say, even before then, the second serve, the anxiety and all the rest of it that would come into his game in big moments. So that's why we then go a little bit further down, and we also go further down in age, which is why we then look towards Sinner and Rune, and those guys get a pass for a bit longer. I mean, I know fans of the sort of mid-ranking, or mid-age players, the sort of 24, 25, 26-year-olds, that go, you know, why aren't you being so harsh on Holger or on Jan? Well, there's a clear reason. We weren't harsh on Steph in 2019 if he had a dip, or in 2018 with Sasha. You know, we saw them win ATP finals or get to Grand Slam semifinals and then, you know, lose to Rafa quite badly or whatever. That's okay. You're still evolving. You're still someone who we think in 2 or 3 years. But there is a point when it's judgment time, you know, and Holger has got 2-3 more years for that to come. I mean, I'm still optimistic that we will see a return to form for him and at some point, you know, very consistent deep Grand Slam runs. But he gets a pass for this year, even if he maybe hasn't quite achieved as much as he did last year. And same with Jannik Sinner as well, for now anyway. Obviously, Sinner's a year or so older, I think. But yeah.
But we are just holding out hope at the moment, John. We're holding our breath. And the current tennis landscape, right now in the present, it's not particularly inspiring. As you're suggesting, we're waiting for these guys, we're giving them passes until maybe they can catch up with the rest of with Novak and Alcaraz, and it's just not happening. And you know, when I talk about depth in the men's field, I don't mean you need a bunch of, you know, 50 good players. I mean you need like 5-6 great players, which is what we used to have. Even Vavrenka is matching Medvedev for how many times he's meeting Novak at the Slams in that period. So he met him 3 times, Novak in the semifinals and finals of Slams, Medvedev 3 times in the last 4 years. And that's not looking at Murray, who made 7, Nadal, who made 7, Federer, who made 8. I mean, these guys are just absurd numbers. And every time they met, it was always something phenomenal, incredibly exciting. That's the kind of feeling we got when Alcaraz played Novak in the Wimbledon final. And that's about the only moment of slam just like craziness we've had this year.
I think Stan is a great name to throw out there as well, because he's the guy who won 3 Grand Slams, and he did so by beating members of the Big Three, and he did so by being a thorn in their side at one point or another, sometimes quite literally in terms of Rafa's back in 2014. But, you know, he's the one who it wouldn't be, you know, Stefanos Tsitsipas when he played Novak in Australia, Casper Ruud in Paris, and Taylor Fritz as well here in New York. For those three matches this year, okay, slightly different stages of the Slam in Taylor's case, but it was just like almost no way this guy's winning. When Stan would play them, when Stan would be sort of number three, number four, number five in the pecking order of likelihood to win the Slam. So that sort of group, that sort of 3 to 10 in the world or 4 to 10 in the world that we're talking about right now. And I'm looking at the top 10 as we speak currently. And, you know, I'm going to leave Holger Rune out for his age. And I do think he is capable of really, Novak on his day, especially over three sets. But listen to this roster of Tsitsipas, Rublev, Sinner, Fritz, Ruud, Zverev. Now, none of those guys can... None of those guys are beating Novak Djokovic or probably Carlos Alcaraz over five sets when Carlos or Novak are at 6 or 7 out of 10.
And, yeah.
And that shouldn't be the case. If you've got depth, then that doesn't happen.
Yeah, exactly right. And I mean, if anybody needs to fact check that and do the head-to-head of those players over Novak and Alcaraz in slams, then it probably speaks for itself. Novak,
I mean, I don't think any of them have beaten him no. Or Carlos at a slam. I'm pretty sure.
Zverev has at the French Open, but that was, you know, that was before.
Oh, Alcaraz. Yeah, with Carlos. Yeah, true. True. I mean, so we've got one. Let's include that because let's be fair. So we've got one win probably across 20 matches, something like that.
Literally yeah. About that.
Which sounds about right. So if Jannik Sinner Jannik Sinner too, especially at Wimbledon, but Stefanos Tsitsipas, whoever, and you could choose any of those players, and I said to you, I think he's got a 5% chance of winning today against Carlos or Novak.
The Sinner Alcaraz rivalry is maybe the only exception to the rule, actually. I will give him that because he did come close.
Sinner was one I sort of held back on, but and he hasn't played Novak, I think, away from Wimbledon from the top of my head, but still, Sinner comes up against Novak in that final yesterday, probably we're seeing a similar result.
Yeah. It's all been a bit doom and gloom. It's certainly kind of how I'm feeling after that. It does feel like, who's going to really challenge Novak next year apart from Alcaraz? We need to see something, somebody, someone emerging again from the woodwork. The biggest hope I've got is that Sinner maximises the power in his game and he does have a chance of kind of reaching those peaks like Stan Wawrinka, right? But at the moment, is that even... it's not a guarantee, obviously. It really is just holding out hope. So, yeah, it'll be interesting to see what happens going forward, John. But at the moment, Alcaraz and Novak are leagues ahead with Medvedev a little behind and then the rest of the pack.
I know we've gone on quite a bit already, but... something that Damien and I were talking about 10 days ago was that who are the sort of players that could cause Novak a problem in that half of the draw? And we were not looking at the top 10. We were not even looking at the top 20. We were picking out randomers like Goyo, for example, or I said Karatsev, for example. He was in the same half. I mean, he didn't get close to playing Novak in the end. But we were just looking at spoilers and people who can be erratic but sensational. Marojan, you know, these are the sort of guys that we were looking at and just going, maybe if they play Novak and just play lights out and have their day. And that's you know, supporting the argument. There's just not a great deal of depth in men's tennis right now at the top of the game. And that's where you sort of need it the most.
Absolutely. Yeah. We need somebody with just a crazy peak in the top 10 again. That's pretty much it. I'd love to see it and it's just not there. You know, somebody like Fernando Gonzalez or something like that. Somebody with just a crazy weapon, something to overpower. But yeah, we're a while away. So on that note, John, I think we'll close up the men's slam chat for now. Thanks for coming on, John. Good to talk to you about the men's US Open. I'm sure we'll have you on very soon. Everybody else, thank you very much for listening. Give us a like, give us a subscribe. Catch you next time on the Online Tennis Podcast. Cheers, guys.